My name is Ken Pierce. I'm a geologist with the U.S. Geological Survey, actually presently retired and emeritus with the U.S. Geological Survey. And my field of focus of specialization is in what's called Quaternary geology and geomorphology. Quaternary geology, you might think of it as the time of the ice ages. It's the last few million years. It's the very tag end of geologic time, but it's also the most important part of geologic time because it affects how we live on the earth and the landscapes around us. The other part of my field of focus is geomorphology, which is the study of the form of the land. And that has it has a lot to do with what geologic processes are acting on the land, why the landscape looks the way it does, what were things that happened in the past or in the present or in a possible future that relate to the form of the land. The center of Yellowstone is a large caldera, and calderas around the world are noted for being restless, various kinds of activity going on, including uplift, subsidence, volcanic eruptions, all kinds of things happen. And Yellowstone is no different. It's a restless caldera. Yellowstone has been deflated and inflated in the last part of Holocene time, or what we might call post-glacial time. And one of the things that I've been working on is documenting changes in the Yellowstone Caldera through time. And part of the geology of Yellowstone is set up really nice for this. There's Yellowstone Lake and a channel of the Yellowstone River that goes across what is the threshold in the center of the caldera. And if the caldera inflates, this makes Yellowstone Lake get higher. If the caldera deflates, this makes Yellowstone Lake get lower. And one of the kind of connections between Yellowstone Lake and this threshold area is a channel of the Yellowstone River that at present is acting like a large pool, as an extension of Yellowstone Lake. But in the past, when the caldera subsided, this area has acted as a channel of the active Yellowstone River, and it's actually so vigorous it's undercutting its banks. It's acting like a vigorous, normal river. And if you go into an area just beyond the threshold of Yellowstone Lake, in this pool section of the Yellowstone River, and auger down, you go through slackwater lake-type deposits, sand deposits, and then you go into a gravel, indicating the river was very active at that time. If we use these same cores to date the time that Yellowstone River was acting like a river instead of a pool, we find that this was about 3,000 years ago. So 3,000 years ago, Yellowstone was deflated, and now it's inflated. And this process of deflation, inflation, I call heavy breathing of the Yellowstone Caldera, because it's a big process. The actual volume of material involved is quite large. One of the people that surveyed Yellowstone is Dan Zuritzen, and he's shown that both the caldera, when it inflates, it swells up, and it, when it deflates, it's a mirror image of the inflation, so that we know that on the short term, the pattern has been a very, very symmetrical inflation and deflation, which again suggests some symmetrical process. Whether this is actually intrusion of magma and somehow it subsiding after that, or some process related to geothermal features such as inflation above a geothermal seal, a breaking of the geothermal seal and subsidence as the hot fluids escape, is part of the process. An intrusion of a magma is thought to be the process. It inflates, then how do you get the deflation? You can't stuff the magma back down the hole it came up. It's going to stay where it is. So it's more likely if magmas are coming in, it keeps uplifting, maybe pausing with uplift. One other thing that we can tell from Yellowstone is that instead of inflating and then inflating and inflating, we can tell that this didn't happen because shorelines of Yellowstone Lake are very close to horizontal. So whatever the process of inflation and deflation is, it's not resulting in a net uplift of the center of the Yellowstone Caldera. The most likely cause for that kind of thing is geothermal fluids, which can come into the system, escape out the sides of the system, come into the system again and escape out to the side. I started with the U.S. Geological Survey in Kentucky, where I was mapping the Ohio River deposits for the U.S. Geological Survey's effort to map the entire state of Kentucky in detail. And after I had been there for about two years, I got a phone call saying, how would you like to come up to Denver and work on the geology of Yellowstone? And we'll give you a week to think this over. And I said, I don't need a week to think it over. I'm really, really ready to go. When I was in graduate school, I thought that I would go into teaching because that's the main exposure that I had to other geologists, other professors. And I started with the Geological Survey thinking, indeed, I'm going to get some research done and then I'll be better qualified for a teaching position. Well, it never worked out that I went into teaching. I moved up to Bozeman, Montana, with the U.S. Geological Survey in 2000. And since I've been here, I've been affiliate faculty with the Department of Earth Sciences at Montana State. And I really enjoyed being able to work with graduate students, to give lectures, to lead field trips at Montana State. It's very rewarding for me to be able to interact with students. Many have graduated and gone into good careers in geology, and it's very rewarding to be part of that story. We're actually standing on a small alluvial fan. The stream came out of the mountainside there, and when it got to this flat floored valley, it built a small alluvial fan. Alluvial fans are kind of one of the easiest things to recognize in the landscape because they're conical shape. They occur where a steep stream course gets to a flatter place. And they have this conical fan shape. My daughter's also a geologist, and she and her students, as you said, Boise State, and she and her students were studying alluvial fans, and they formed an alluvial fan club.